courageous conversation on BCTV is supported by Brentwood.
Welcome to Courageous Conversation. Pastor Routte here. We have a tremendous show for you tonight. We're going to talk about the educational system and some of the issues that are being looked at and being dealt with. And we have with us today two very, very important warriors in that day-to-day struggle. To my left here is Kathy Moyer, who is a teacher in the Lebanon district, teacher of her, first grade. Mm-hmm. Right.
Yes.
You're starting little kids out to learn how to count, and speak, mm-hmm. and how to think.
Yes, yes.
Yeah, so
major emphasis on reading.
Yeah. So how many years have you been?
This is 32 for me.
Oh, yeah? So yes. You must know something, huh?
I hope I do. Yes.
Well, I know Kathy. She's a wonderful person. And I know the fact that she not only knows something, she's a teacher. She teaches not only her little kids, she teaches whoever she's talking with, mm-hmm. you know, that's who you are.
Yes, I am.
You mm-hmm. are a teacher. It's your profession. And yes. you have faith in that.
I do. I do. This is something that I feel God has given me a purpose for. I really believe that from early age, I've always pretended to be a teacher. And I would teach my cousins and my stuffed animals, and it's what I wanted to be, and God put it in my heart, and that is what I am today.
Amen.
Amen.
All right. I guess we can take up the offering now. Oh, boy. Speaking of teaching, you know, not only teaching, but administrating is Dr. Khalid Mumin, the superintendent of the Reading School District. Oh. And, you know, I just wanted you to know this. I got to say this publicly, that you are a blessing to the Reading area. I live in this area.
Thank you. Thank
you. Know, and it's a blessing, absolute blessing. The fact that you take this on, it's not just a job. It's something that... you're going to see this thing through.
Yes.
It's just wonderful to, you know, the changes you've had.
Yes, and thank you so much, Pastor Routte. I'm just humbled to be here this evening and to be surrounded, again, by great people and, of course, teachers, educators.
Thank you.
This journey begins in the classroom.
Amen.
And I tell you, it is a spiritual journey.
Yes, it is.
To do this work. Teaching is a spiritual journey. You get to impact so many lives. You get to inspire so many young people. And, you know, looking to the future or looking to the future with new vision, it's an opportunity for me, along with my team, to live through these young people's lives vicariously. It's a beautiful thing. So
yes.
I'm always humbled and proud and excited
yes.
to be
yes.
next to
yes.
people who care about kids. You know my story, Pastor Routte. You know, teachers essentially saved my life, motivated me to be great when I didn't think that I had any type of greatness. We're constantly pushing me to infinite possibilities, which I just was following along with them. They said, do it. I did it. And look what happened.
Yeah.
They knew something that I didn't know. And they were such unique people in the classrooms because my mom, my dad had all the answers, but I didn't believe them. I didn't believe them. I lived with them. I didn't believe them. But the educators who were able to see something in me
yeah.
from dealing with me from 6 to 8 hours a day
yeah.
and actually said, mm-hmm. you know, when you grow up, you could be something of greatness. And so again, I'm humbled to be here this evening, with you, Pastor Routte, and of course, with a beautiful and lovely and talented teacher.
Thank you. Because you transcend lives,
and which is powerful.
Yes, yeah. This is well said, bro.
Yes, well said.
But it's still an uphill journey, mm-hmm. Right now, because you have so many other things that are blocking that effort. So, you say, well, I'm going to have to approach this in a little bit different way when you see new problems coming in, surfacing. Mm-hmm. And so I guess we have an opportunity to lift that up and perhaps get some insight into this particular time that we're in now, mm-hmm. as to how we deal with some of those intractable problems, mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And we can just lift up the refugees that come into your system, how are you dealing with it? You have an additional 375.
Very close, and the population has become very transient because we have students who are starting to return to Puerto Rico, withdraw and return to Puerto Rico. But when you look at students, it all revolves around equity, and equity means all.
Yeah.
When children show up on the doorsteps at Reading School District, they are entitled to a high quality education with dynamic educators. And we have that mindset. Mm-hmm. We work steadfastly not to look at ethnicity, skin tone, learning levels. We are addressing all kids.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And what we found to be successful is that it takes the administration to have the presence of mind to empower the building leaders and the teachers to do what they do best, and that's lead kids. Through that empowerment, we're able to become more efficient, because when people see me, if you get caught up in the title of superintendent, I represent the system, and the system doesn't move fast. So you have to become more efficient. And that means mobilizing the good people that you have in the buildings. And that's why my teachers are phenomenal. My support staff are phenomenal. Everyone is in this journey together, from our bus drivers to our custodians to our cafeteria monitors. Everyone's in this journey together because every little step counts for our kids. We're not only in the business of having to educate kids. We have to nurture kids. We have to show them love. We have to say, looking at socioeconomic status, your label is underserved. No, here you're loved. Mm-hmm. You're loved. Mm-hmm. You're a gem. You're the best. You're the brightest, and you have to continue to inspire our kids to do great things.
Yeah.
So I can sit here and gloat and say, I'm the best superintendent. That's not the case. It's the team of educators that surround me that really, really do the heavy lifting with moving our kids towards pathways of success. That's the recipe.
That's wonderful.
That's the recipe.
Well, we know that Kathy's working with that same spirit and is having the same kind of result.
First of all, I thank you for praising your teachers and your staff for what they do, because we do work very hard. We have children coming in that have not actually entered the classroom for quite a while because it took them a while to register. And when they finally came in, within a month's time, I had 5 children come from Puerto Rico, some of them knowing no English whatsoever. Mm-hmm. And we have a lot of teachers who cannot speak Spanish. I can.
Oh,
which is, it has been, and again, God's led me to that, to have that love for bilingualism. And the children come in, and there's an immediate bond. They come in, and they don't know English, and they're lost. They don't know anybody. And I immediately start speaking to them. And even those teachers who don't know Spanish, they have such a warm heart. Mm-hmm. And these are our children. Mm-hmm. And it's been a challenge, but it's also been an accomplishment that we can do this for anyone. I mean, we're dealing with not just Puerto Ricans that are coming in from the hurricane-inflicted areas, but we're dealing with other cultures, too. From Macedonia, from Egypt, and, you know, learning their cultures is so welcoming. It's an experience.
It's beautiful.
It is. But that's what it means to be an American, don't you think?
Oh, absolutely.
You know, we don't know the value of that. In fact, I've had it, one of the parents that I had wanted to bring here tonight, Gus Daniels, he was talking about how important it is to teach our kids that are raised in America, to teach them to be able to speak a second language at an early age. And you have to teach parents to be in on that at an early age, because it's what Gus says, at 2 years old, kids could gather. You can teach them at 2 years old language and how important that is. And he says, I've taught my grandchild, because my son, who's a doctor, was in school, so I had to take care of the grandchild. And I began teaching her Mandarin Chinese. And now she's 11 and she plays the cello and she can speak Chinese. You know, I wanted him to meet you, you know. Because when he talks about the game that he ran and to get six kids up and around on his own, you would say, "Whoa, give this guy a Medal of Honor because, you know, what he's done." But he says it was the teacher's advisory group that taught him how to do it.
And you're on to a great point, Pastor Routte, when you said, doesn't that, the question you asked, you said, doesn't that speak of America? And I'm paraphrasing. And, you know, I look at the years of history in regards to how America is a place of opportunity.
Yes.
And so we're the melting pot.
Yes.
But there's some symbolism with the melting pot. You're in the melting pot and you melt together. That could be somewhat of being assimilated. That's assimilation. Then we move to the salad bowl, where each individual has their uniqueness.
Yes.
And in Reading, I say, hey, it's salsa here. You know, it's uniqueness with spice.
Yes.
And you have to be able to appreciate everyone that's in this big journey.
Yeah.
That's what it means to be American.
Yeah.
And we know that education is that key.
Yeah.
Yes.
That key to that door that opens the pathway to success.
Yes. And children are so resilient.
Yes.
Don't ever doubt the capabilities of a young child because they soak it up
and
they learn very quickly.
You're right on point, Ms. Moyer, when I told the story earlier about teachers seeing things in me that I didn't see, and one of the things, and I'm having an epiphany now, was my favorite teacher was Mr. Smith, Mr. Richard Smith, 10th grade teacher, English teacher, Alney High School. And we are kids coming from Logan, West Oak Lane, small section of the Northeast in Hunting Park. And he came in and he enlightened us to the works of Shakespeare.
Woo!
And he said, this is the best rapper in the world, William Shakespeare. We said, get out of here. Run DMC's the best. And he began to go through the prologue of Macbeth. And he said, now here's what we're going to read. Now you have an option. Do you want to read the abridged version with all the pictures, or do you want to read the unabridged version like they're doing at LaSalle Prep? And we said, whoa, we want the right side, unabridged, unabridged. And we, within a week, we made it through Macbeth, the unabridged version of Macbeth. And from there, we wanted to see the play. So we began to go to Temple University to see the play at work, to see the words play out on the stage.
Yeah.
And then realizing that I'm sitting there with students from all over the city of Philadelphia, some from Masterman, which is one of the best schools, still one of the best schools in the state, and being able to hold a conversation around the works of Shakespeare, knowing that I came from Logan, knowing that, hey, wow, this is even in the playing field. I'm just as smart as these guys. He really, really pushed me to have that thirst and ferocity to be well educated and to be smart.
There's
it's
pride.
Cool to be smart.
Lots of pride.
It's
cool to be smart.
And then you can understand what's going on in the world, the whole world. He opened it up for you.
Yes.
You know, is that. And I realized that too myself. In fact, my understanding happened when the Enlightenment was taking Latin. Mm-hmm. You know, in my school, you know, 4 years of Latin, and Caesar's Gallic Wars. All right, and the emphasis there was Caesar when he was talking about. He said, educare. He said, what is that? Translate that. He made sure that, and that was to lead to, and to lead to higher ground. Educare, to educate. Mm-hmm. There's that term. And it's never left me in terms of leading somebody to higher ground. That's my whole game.
Mm-hmm.
is to do that. Mm-hmm. To, you know, higher spiritual value, educare, and it's a military term by Caesar in Caesar's Gallic Wars. Mm-hmm. Imagine that.
Imagine that.
Now, in our war to defeat ignorance is what we're talking about. That's what education is now, and leading to higher ground. And you gave a wonderful example.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Somebody dispelled your ignorance in one area, and then you're able to see,
right.
You know, and then you see that in music, to understand Bach, you understand.
It's easy to be ignorant.
Yeah.
It's very easy to be ignorant. It takes a lot to learn, to be intelligent, and you have to have that inspiration to do great things. That's hard work.
Yes, sir.
Yes.
That's hard work. So you need people along the way.
Yes.
Right.
Teachers.
Right. Coaches. Exactly. That's our job.
Coaching and pushing and pulling at times and motivating students to really be able to believe in the journey.
That's right.
So, you know, hats off to the teachers.
All children can learn.
Yeah.
But they're coming in, and maybe our definition of trauma might be one thing, but their definition of trauma can be another, such as, are they fed breakfast?
Mm-hmm.
You know, have they had a good night's sleep?
Right.
You know, their trauma can be so, to us, like, I mean, I was brought up in a home where I've always had food, and I've had shelter, and I've had clothing.
Right.
But what about that other child out there who may not have had that? We're dealing with that.
Yes.
And all children can learn under the right circumstances.
Yes, right. But you have ways of detecting that in your situation there. And that's why you praise your teachers who are able to pinpoint, just like she's pinpointing it.
That's right. And speaking very eloquently about it, it's all about forming relationships and understanding the kids that are in your classroom.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, right.
You have to understand that their journey very, very well may be different than your personal journey.
Absolutely.
And story.
Right.
And so that's key number one, is you're able to understand the kids and understand where they come from to be able to educate them. The second piece is not counting out the parent. You have to engage the parents. Mm-hmm. You know, I have this saying that parent involvement is old like gold. That means we have a PTO meeting, or PTA meeting, parents should show up and get to understand the school. No. It's about engagement. You have to go out and meet the parents where they are.
Yes.
To be able to inspire
Amen.
Them
yes.
to be involved in the educational process.
Right.
And it's a journey that we're all in it together. The third thing is you have to have high expectations for kids. It doesn't matter where you come from, how you got there. The expectations must be high if you're preparing students for something better.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. You have to continue to coach, as you said.
Yes.
You have to continue to coach, push, pull. You have to be able to see something much greater than what the kid can see as they live carpe diem for the day. Yeah. And as adults and as educators, as teachers, as administrators, we have to take the responsibility to create the conditions for positive interaction with our kids.
Yeah.
Right.
Home may be one way. The journey to school may be another way.
Yeah, mm-hmm. That's right.
But school should be utopia.
Yeah.
They should be fed. There should be love. There should be rigorous instruction.
Yes.
There should be a combination of it all. The kids should not come through the doors of a school and feel disenfranchised, afraid, pushed down by any adult in the school system.
Right.
You have to be able to have that mindset and that responsibility.
Right.
It's our responsibility to lead the kids. Who else, who knows education better than us?
That's right.
Mm-hmm. I mean, we got a lot of degrees at this table right now.
Yeah.
Right. Our kids, they don't have one.
Yeah.
Their parents may not have one, but that doesn't mean you count them out and you talk down to them. You continue to push them up.
Yes.
You continue to push them up. Yeah. So, and it's an exciting journey. And I think when your head and heart alignment is in place, then you're able to map that onto some information or background information that you have received from your students by forming relationships. You can really build something that's just extraordinary and magnificent.
Yeah. I like what you just said, you know, in terms of building a relationship and getting new energy and new information about how to do something. It's always there. Mm-hmm. When you see somebody evolve and say, yeah, I remember you. I saw you in second grade. Yeah. you know what I mean? And I look at you, you know? And when you see the talent that kids, you know, they get out and say, yeah, I know how to do a two-step now.
Yes, you know? Yes.
When I remember when I coached football at high school level and teaching a kid, you know, how to play football and how to do a long trap play. And you know, it was a Polish kid, square shouldered, you know, fairly intelligent, teaching him how to knock down somebody who is 220 pounds, you know, and he's only 185, and say, well, it's speed that when you arrive at impact, your speed can then bring that, what your weight level and your force of your weight will equal his 120 pounds. And that's what we call, in physics, mass times velocity equal the force. Mm-hmm. So, in other words, you run as hard as you can, and when you hit, all right, he said, oh yeah, I see that. You know that kid understood that, told his physics teacher later on, I know mass times velocity equal force. And whenever we call his play, you could see his mouth begins to water because he understood what that was. Mm-hmm. You know, just, you know, that whole concept to understand physics.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And again, it's all about connections. And, and I'm thinking back when I was in the classroom and how I was able to be successful. I had a thirst to learn everything about the kids.
Yeah.
To see if I could get them into, and back then it was, we were using the framework, the Mosaic Book of Thought, in regards to, can kids make three connections?
Yeah.
And I was an English teacher, so text to text, text to self, text to world.
Yeah.
And you just hit all three connections.
Yeah.
You know, text to text, you gave him the textbook knowledge around physics.
Yeah.
Text to self, oh, if I apply this formula, I could be successful.
Yeah.
Text to world, let me share this with my teacher.
Yeah.
Let me share this with my teacher and see how physics impacts the world.
Yeah.
And that's what it's all about. You have to have multiple tools to be able multiple tools to be able to encourage kids to be successful.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's right.
And I think you need to touch with them in an emotional mm-hmm. aspect as well.
Amen.
To know that yeah. I love you, I care about mm-hmm. you,
right.
and I understand that this may be going on, but here I am, you can talk to me.
Yeah, right.
And when you finally meet and they know that you understand them,
yeah.
that's when learning takes place.
That's right. Trust.
That's right.
Because there can't be any kind of resentment or...
It's trust.
I mean, I know this teacher loves me, mm-hmm. and I often even have my children call me mom from time to time because we do have that bond. Mm-hmm. Yeah. But that's when learning takes place.
Yep, that's
you
right.
have to reach them in that love. I love you.
Right.
And this is when... Yeah. yeah, you're going to do mm-hmm. better.
We had a professional development session 3 years ago.
Yeah,
And we had an extravagant affair at Reading's Phillies Stadium. Just beautiful, but we had some guest speakers. I had a keynote, but we also had an excerpt from an educator who has since passed away, Rita Pearson, and Rita Pearson said very openly, it's one of the most, it has some of the most hits on TED Talks. Mm-hmm. And she said very clearly, she said, we have to get out of this mindset that it's always about toughness with kids. She said, kids don't follow teachers that they don't like.
Mm-hmm.
You have to have some qualities about you that encourage the kids to like you by knowing
Absolutely.
That you care about them.
Yeah. Yeah.
For them to want to aspire
right.
to be good or
right.
aspire to be great. They must yeah. like you.
Yeah. Yeah.
And that's totally contradictory to,
yeah.
you know, back in the day when I was taught, no, you may not like me, but you're going to respect me. Well, now it's give to get.
Mm-hmm.
You have to give respect to get respect.
Yeah.
And kids will follow educators that they like, admire, mm-hmm. care about. And you said something powerful, love.
Yeah.
Love. I tell kids all the time that I love them.
Yes.
And I mean it.
Yes. Yeah.
It, because I can see in their eyes, I say, you know, 10 years from now, and this kid's going to be great.
Yeah.
And they, you know, hopefully they'll remember this interaction.
Yeah.
But this is how I feel. I love you. I see the potential in
Absolutely.
You.
Yeah, that's right.
And every child has it in one
right.
way or another.
That's right. right. And they
yes.
hear that song.
Yes.
You know?
That's right.
Yeah.
Yeah. Who loved you, baby?
Yeah. That's right. That's right.
That's right. And
that's
I'm
right.
trying to drop this on you right now.
Mm. That's right.
Yeah, listen up. You know.
That's right.
And there's nothing more rewarding than an older student coming back and saying, I wish I were in your class again.
Mm.
Yeah.
You know, because you know that you have that connection.
Yes.
And, you know, whether it was an insecure child or if it was just a child who needed some mentoring, it really touches your heart because you know that in some way or another you met their need.
Yes. Yes.
And that's what it's all about.
Yeah, right. You know, when they began to add, that's nothing but 2 + 2 = 4.
That's right. Yeah. We're molding them for the future. They're our future.
Yes. Yeah, that's right, to be able mm-hmm. to understand that. And that's one of our greatest resources is to be able to educate people so that they can actually fit into a democracy. A democracy demands that you have people that are intelligent and that can make good decisions.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. You know, it demands, and the thing is, you know, how can they eliminate the money that you're supposed to get for the Reading School District, and they just throw, well, I don't want to use that word, just throwing it away.
Well, I think to like, for example, today, from an administrative standpoint, it's 11 o'clock today.
Yeah.
Our eyes were glued to the television screen or to the computer as Governor Wolf presented his budget aspirations.
Yeah.
And we just began to jump up and cheer as he has in his budget proposal to put $100 million into public education.
Yeah.
what that means for us.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
It means a few more million dollars coming to Reading School District.
Right.
Governor Wolf did a phenomenal job three years ago now, where he presented his budget aspirations here at 10th and Penn Elementary School.
Yeah.
My apologies, 10th and Green Elementary School.
Yeah.
We were his guest at our elementary school. And he talked about the fair funding formula and some of the things that needed to be taken into account for kids from underserved communities, where we're trying to flatten the poverty line in regards to your zip code determining what level of funding you receive.
Yeah.
And in that budget address, he spoke of looking at kids with ELL needs, or English language learners, students who have special education needs, students who come from communities with a high poverty index.
Yeah.
And he said, this is the way that we can really right the wrongs of the past.
That's right. Yeah.
And today, again, he presented $100 million for public ed in his proposal, and said, wow, this is exciting.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
More resources. I said, you know, with our kids, they have the capacity to be great. And we're very used in both of our environments.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Teachers have no problems making soup out of stones.
Right, right.
Just imagine if you get all the ingredients to make that soup.
Yes.
It will be something that, you know, we could take a kid from Reading and stand them side by side with a kid from New Hope, Solberry.
Yes, sir.
And right. I've been in both.
Yes.
You know, here in Reading School District, we're coming in at about $8,500 per pupil. I've been in New Hope Solberry, where it was $24,000 per pupil.
Wow.
And that was back in the early 2000s.
Yeah.
It's even higher now.
Yes.
But the expectations have to remain the same, that the kids at New Hope Solberry have $24,000 to be able to compete at this high level. We still have to push kids, have the expectation that they're able to compete.
Yeah.
To compete. Yeah. This education, this diploma should be the prerequisite for them to compete at those high levels.
Right.
You know, so when you talk about funding is a barrier.
Yes.
But it's a barrier. It's not an end-all.
That's right.
That's right.
It's not an end-all. Yeah. So
I like the way you think.
I say this all the time, and I'm telling you, Mrs. Moyer got me going here. You can take, there were positions that I've been in, and I could honestly say that Ronald McDonald could do the job.
Yeah.
When you're in school districts like Lebanon, like Reading, mm-hmm. like Allentown, like Philadelphia, Hazleton, Harrisburg, mm-hmm. Coatesville, Chester,
right.
You know, you have to have the most phenomenal teachers in the classrooms. Because it's more than just reading, writing, and arithmetic.
Yes.
Right, yeah.
Yes.
You have to have a teacher that has the capacity to do everything.
Yeah.
My teachers are the Swiss Army knife of education.
Woo!
They got every tool.
Is it
going to be nurturing?
Yeah.
Is it going to be nurturing along with pushing high mm-hmm. academic standards? Is it going to be, here's the reality of what success, what education does. Here's the reality from an economic standpoint.
Right.
You gotta be real with the kids.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Your conditions now, you know how you can get out of these conditions? You could change everything and uplift your family with this diploma and in that next step, in that next step,
yes.
whether it be college or career ready.
Right, right.
Yeah.
You know, we're we're here in Berks County, where there are opportunities in regards to trades,
yes.
where students leave high school in poverty
right. yes.
with some training.
Right.
And are able to step right over the poverty line.
Right.
$40,000 jobs in
yes.
manufacturing.
That's right.
$50,000, $60,000 jobs in engineering.
Yes.
And then we still have trades jobs here in Berks
right.
County. So we have to look at the positives and how close and accessible those opportunities are.
Yeah.
And so economics is a barrier.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But it's not a situation where the door is closed.
Exactly.
That's right.
You have to continue to push.
Exactly.
In fact, the manufacturers and people there in the business world are always looking for trained people you know, and people that have good backgrounds, and et cetera, to be able to be honest, mm-hmm. forthright, mm-hmm. hardworking. Mm-hmm. And we have people that understand that, and it's a matter of getting their kids to follow that kind of understanding. But there are some things that I found in my whole education and understanding that if I did have some money, what I would do would be to take the kids from, you say, the Reading area or Lebanon area, and for the summer, take them across the country. Have you ever gone across the whole country?
Not the entire country.
Yeah.
But I'm working my way.
Yeah.
I'm a works in progress.
Yeah.
But again, it started at an early age of having the opportunity to be around people from other cultures, other countries.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
To be able to understand them and say, man, we are one.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
We are one.
Yeah.
And to understand, you know, the different nuances that occur demographically.
Yes.
Oh, I was an English teacher, so I was fascinated with the language.
Yeah.
You know, from having hoagies in Philly to subs in the Midwest. from greasy to greasy.
Mm-hmm.
And then listening to my mom's side of the family, coming from Wilmington, North Carolina, where you have you have different elements of Gullah language and trying to understand the dialects.
Yes.
It was very intriguing to me. But again, the beauty of being American.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
The beauty of being in America, you're allowed to be
absolutely.
Who you are.
Yeah, that's right.
And you're allowed to learn from one another.
Yeah. Yeah.
That makes this thing, that makes this world go round.
Yeah. Yeah.
And I think teachers have the ultimate mindset of equity, openness, compassion, to be able to have kids. And I mean, we were talking before the show in regards to your student demographics and how you have kids from several countries speaking several different languages from different religious backgrounds and ethnicities, but they're able to come together as a family in your classroom.
Absolutely.
Because you have the capacity, the skill set, again, to be able to bring them together and keep them focused on education.
Yeah.
It's about togetherness. We're one.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. But engineering a trip across the country shows, you know, not only how big this place is, you know, that you live in, that you're not in this cubicle in Philly or New York or someplace, and that the world is not enclosed in just this, but that you're a part of something. To go, you know, in Midwest and to see corn being raised to perspective point, 50 miles, 60 miles an hour, and you know, and you could be traveling for hours because there's that much corn, all right? And then all of a sudden, boom, you see the Rockies. This looks like a tidal wave coming at you, you know? To be able to experience that, what? Where am I?
That's right.
You know, to have a kid experience that.
Yeah. And that's also exposure to vocabulary.
Yeah.
You know, I have first graders, the word cattle came up. They don't even know what cattle is. So we have to talk about that. This is cattle. And then possibly, like, we went to Lake Tobias, and they didn't know these certain animals even existed or what they even looked like.
Yeah.
But exposing them to that culture and to those things that they've never had exposure to before, you know, it's a real wide learning experience.
Mm-hmm.
But we have to provide that for them because they won't have it otherwise. Yeah,
absolutely, absolutely.
Yeah.
And those are some of the ways. It's not only just video stuff, but actual experiential touching the rest of the world. And then the people that live in those places, you know, to go to see the Old Faithful geyser and see in that wonderful park. And, you know, to be able to see that, the appreciation for it. And you know, that as they grow up, they say, no, you better keep that park going and not let people drill for oil in national parks. Mm-hmm. Because these, you know, when I was a kid, I went there. Mm-hmm. To be able to understand with the value and that what your particular stake in this country, you know, because it provides an education for you and your grandkids.
Mm-hmm. And thinking of the kids now and how, as educators, we're competing with so much multimedia.
Yes, sir.
And you have kids that, you know, they can experience some of these opportunities,
yes,
through right. multimedia devices. And I will say, I do have an addiction, and I don't watch much television besides SportsCenter and CNN.
Yeah.
sometimes Fox. But I have one program that I watch religiously, and it's Anthony Bourdain.
Food.
Yes, because you're understanding and learning about cultures,
yes,
through food.
Yes.
Right.
And he's taking you around the world.
Yeah. Right.
And I said, wow, how magnificent is this?
Yes.
You know, I'm in Tanzania, I'm in China, I'm all over the place
right.
with the food. And then I'm able to take a couple of recipes, start to make the dishes myself.
Yeah.
And that has become somewhat of a entryway.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, and you get to see how people interact around the world. And I think the way education is now, when I was talking about connections with the Mosaic Book of Thought, the text of text, text itself, text the world, we have to be very much strategic
yeah.
in how we align and use those resources in our canon.
Yeah.
In our canon to mm-hmm. help our kids.
Yes.
It comes back down to mm-hmm. engagement and understanding.
Right. Yeah.
Meeting
that's
them right. where they are.
That's
they're right,
right
here.
Yep.
We need to be there to be able yeah. to teach them how to move forward.
And how to use it.
Yeah. How to use yep. it properly.
Yeah, right.
Yes,
yeah,
sir.
That's good. Speaking of using it, we have a home viewer. Home viewer?
Yes, good afternoon or good evening. I'm really enjoying your show. Sorry I couldn't be there tonight, but I just want to make one quick comment. One of the things that really helped my children, I had four of them and had three in college at the same time, was the Explorers Post run by the Boy Scouts of America. Mm-hmm. My oldest son, who's a doctor now, he went to the dental post, and it's after school about once or twice a month, and my daughter Maria, nursing post, law post, communication, and she came back to Reading and worked for WEEU doing traffic. So I just wanted to throw that's a good thing that maybe could help children that they're not sure what the career they want to take. Mm-hmm. I think it begins at the ninth grade. They have a law post, an aviation post, through the Boy Scouts of America. It's on Pottsville Pike, I think it is. But I'm sorry I couldn't be with y'all tonight, but I'm really, really enjoying your show, and thank y'all for the good work you're doing. Thank you, Reverend Luther.
Okay.
Have a great night, y'all.
Yeah.
Thank you for tuning in.
Right.
Take care. Bye-bye. Thank you.
Right. Yeah. Yeah. He was supposed to be here. He got sick. So, you know. And but it's good that he, mm-hmm. you know, he's a wonderful, wonderful man that you got, you know. Be nice for him to. We have yeah. lunch one time that you say you could be able to talk with him.
Yes.
You know, because he himself is an inspiration as to what he's done, because he wants to give.
Yeah.
You know, this is what I experienced. And, you know, he was a tradesman, you know, working with concrete. And he was able to do a miraculous thing. And see, and that's what we are. We're in the search for the miraculous. We know that it can be done every day.
Mm-hmm.
You know, mm-hmm. you're dealing with miraculous things.
Right.
Because you're dealing with the human being.
Right,
and
right.
you're developing human being self-consciousness. You are a human being. You know you can actually rule the universe. You have that capability, kid. Huh, what?
yeah.
You know, but that's you know, that's the gift that each person has.
We try to offer too, at our district, we offer Cub Scouts.
Yeah.
Within the buildings. We also started today the Good News Club, where they're allowed to sign up to hear the Word of God.
Yes.
After school. So we're giving them those opportunities, and
yeah.
I think it's wonderful.
Yeah.
We also have a multicultural festival every so many years where, you know, we all get together and we pick a certain area that we're going to focus on, and we do everything within our atrium at the high school to display that culture, whether it be Spanish or, you know, whatever it might be, so that we can offer the families the different kinds of food, and this is what they're, this is what they wear, and this, these are the kinds of things that we make.
Yeah, and cultural understanding. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Right.
Yeah.
That's a blessing, you know. And the thing is, we've been blessed. You know, I was blessed by having wonderful parents, and I was blessed in so many different ways. And the thing is, one of the biggest things that I had to learn in the, you know, being blessed like I have been, is not to be arrogant. Mm-hmm. You know, to think I'm all that. You know, and you know, but I had peers that would tell me, "Well, you're not all that because you know you've got."
I think it's always a journey.
Yeah.
It's a journey, and I think every opportunity is a learning opportunity.
Yes, it is.
I'm still learning, and I words resonate with me. And one of my close mentors, Dr. Freeman Hrabowski, the president of University of Maryland, Baltimore County, was featured in Time as one of the 100 most influential people in the U.S. a few years ago. And so I call him, and he gives me his time. He's very gracious with his time. And he says, and I'll talk to him. He always asks the question, what keeps you up at night? Then I express what keeps me up at night. And he says, Brother Khalid, always remember to stay humble, careful, and prayerful.
Woo! There it is.
Yes.
Humble, careful, and prayerful.
Amen.
And that, right there, no matter what issue that was keeping me up at night, I say, humble, careful, prayerful.
Yeah.
That's right.
See it through. Humble, careful, prayerful.
I love it. I love it.
Yes.
You know, that's why we take that one home.
Yes.
You know,
good.
Write that
good,
down
good, good.
And say, there it is, because that's wonderful. You're a pretty nice guy there, Kelly. That's right. You are. You really are. You know, we know Kathy is a beautiful person, but that, you know, you can see she's on another level.
That's right.
God.
That's right.
You know? It's just wonderful for you to be here, you know?
Thank you.
And it's, your mother did a good job, and daddy, her parents are just absolutely, hopefully one day you'll see them, you'll see how nice she is, you know? Well, we're gonna have to say goodbye. Imagine that.
That went fast.
Did it go fast?
Yes.
I thought it
have
did.
Have a good time, and I'm here with you, Pastor.
We're having so much fun, yeah. So, once again, Courageous Conversation. We want to thank Kathy Moyer and Dr. Khalid Mumin. Thank you so much for being here.
You're welcome.
Thank you.
It was a pleasure.
Thank you.
Yeah. Okay. And that's it.
Courageous Conversation on BCTV is supported by Brentwood.